The B Reactor Park, the Manhattan Project National Park, is unique among the national park systems for a couple of reasons. First, because it's a joint partnership of the Department of Energy and the National Park System. The Department of Energy owns the facilities and maintains them. The National Park System is responsible for the interpretation. A number of the facilities on site are part of that National Park System. The second thing that makes this park unique is its location. There's three locations. That Oak Ridge, Tennessee was responsible for uranium work, Hanford was responsible for plutonium work, and Los Alamos, New Mexico was responsible, was where the product of those two sites was sent so that they could build a bomb. And that was where they did the engineering, the design, the fabrication of the bomb. Three parts of this park, Oak Ridge, Los Alamos, and Hanford, were the best, by the way. We have the most interesting exhibits. Nothing else compares to B Reactor. I've been to all three. I feel like I can say that in all honesty. Plan on visiting the other three because all three sites are very excellent in what they present. What we're going to do today. The Hanford site consisted initially of about 640 square miles, bounded by Rattlesnake Mountain on the west, the Columbia River on the east, the Saddle Mountains to the north, and roughly where we're at now to the south, the city of Richland area. What we're going to do today is drive out Highway 240 towards the Columbia River. It's about 25 miles. About half a mile this side of the Columbia River, we're going to turn inland and go in about 2 miles to the B Reactor. All told, you'll have about 2 hours at the reactor. Planned on exploring it to be a nuclear engineer, and ended up a few years later making a career transition to the profession of health physics, which is a fancy name for radiation protection. I retired about 5 years ago. My particular specialty was monitoring what kind of radioactivity might be taken inside workers because of inhalations or swallowing or wounds, as opposed to what they might be exposed to just from sources outside of the body. We called it internal dosimetry. So it was a good profession. I liked it. They wanted to have no towns over 1,000 population within 20 miles. It needed an abundant water supply, hopefully clean and cold, and it needed good electrical power. There were about 1,500 people. It was well removed from towns of any size. It had the Columbia River, which was a massive source of clean, fresh water of pretty high purity and cold year-round, running around 50 degrees. It was the most prosperous ranch in this area. We had about 400 acres that were farmed. That is the first stop on the pre-Manhattan Project tour. Have shielding casks on them that were used for transporting the fuel from the reactor here, where it was manufactured essentially, to the separations facility 7 miles inland, T plant in particular, during World War II, where it was dissolved and the plutonium separated. It was highly radioactive, which is why those casks are heavily shielded. And you'll hear more about that inside too.
Hallelujah. The question is peculiar, I'd give a lot of dough. If only I could know. The answer to my question, is it yes or is it no? Does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? If your mother says don't chew it, do you swallow it in spite? Can you catch it on your tonsils? Can you heave it left and right? Does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? Here comes a blushing bride. The groom is by her side. Up to the altar, just as steady as Gibraltar, while the groom has got the ring, and it's such a pretty thing. But as he slips it on her finger, the choir begins to sing.
Let me point out some of the features you're looking at here, and then we'll go into the reactor itself. Up on your left on this gantry, you see long tubes. Those are called process tubes. Those are in the reactor behind these nozzles that you see. There are 2,004 of these process tubes in the reactor. Those are spares that you see up there because occasionally they have to replace one. Behind me is an elevator, this white structure. It would go up and down to allow the workers to reach any and all of the process tubes. This is another elevator on my left. It says metal loader. That is how they move the fuel, the uranium slugs, up and down to that level that they need it to be in order to load the reactor. This is a 1/10 scale model. From the front of the reactor that you're looking at to the rear face, which looks just like the front face, is about 42 feet. So that gives you an idea of the size. The core of the reactor, as we said, was graphite. This is graphite. This is manufactured graphite. It's essentially the same material, number 2 pencil lead. But this is extraordinarily pure, so it was manufactured for that reason. There are substances in the nuclear world that will absorb neutrons, and you didn't want that to happen. So they manufactured this. They used petroleum coke and coal tar pitch, and the manufacturing was done along the steelmaking area of the United States in World War II around the Great Lakes. Rough castings, 48, almost 50 inches long and more than 4 inches square. Then they came to the site where they were machined. That is a model of how the graphite is laid up in the reactor, exactly how it's laid up. That shows you the geometry of the process tubes. And again, each of those blocks weighs about 50 pounds. So 75,000 of those are in this reactor, 75,000 blocks. All machined here on site. Each of these holes that were bored, were the process tubes. So they went front to back, and that's what went through the reactor. And that's what would hold the uranium fuel and also allow for the water surrounding the fuel to come through the reactor to cool it. Outside of this core, which is 36 feet across, 36 feet high, and 28 feet deep, were cast iron blocks, 10 inches or so in width. And you see little tubes hanging out of these. These cast iron blocks, this was known as the thermal shield. Its role was to knock down or to absorb the gamma radiation coming out of the process. And as a result of that, they got very hot. So they were cooled. And if you look up on top of the reactor or on the side and top, if you can find these pigtails, that is the location of the cast iron blocks. Give you another idea of the dimensions of the reactor. Outside of that thermal shield was another shield. We refer to it as the biologic shield, some 52 inches or so. You see orange and silver. The orange was sheets of this wood press product. Commercial name for this? Masonite, still made today. Masonite, or the wood press product, has hydrogen, the makeup of it. Its presence would absorb or reflect the neutrons emanating from the chain reaction going on in the reactor. And that allowed the silver, which was steel, to absorb those neutrons. On top of the reactor, you see these were big containers of boron balls, boron nickel-coated balls, just like this. The things you see sticking out, I'll just raise them. These were control rods, or vertical safety rods. These would be positioned in the reactor. And this is a vertical safety rod. Stainless steel, but you see that it's knuckled. And the reason for that is to allow the rods to drop in the event there was any shifting of the graphite. If you look at the model over there, this graphite is not fastened together. There are keyways to align it, but it is not fastened together. The entire assembly had about a 1-inch thick boilerplate surrounding the entire contraption, if you will, and this sealed the reactor to be airtight. And the reason for that is they were circulating helium gas, refrigerated helium gas, through the reactor to take the heat away from the graphite. You could not get water on the graphite, so they used the helium to do that. So let's talk a little bit about the water coming in. You see the piping on here, and that's what you're seeing up here in these nozzles. So You saw the river, and the reason, again, the river, we're positioned along the river. Pump house that Gene explained brought the water up to that big reservoir, settling basin, and from there it went into a water treatment plant. And by the way, the development of the water treatment plant by DuPont in World War II became the standard for the U.S. for cities. From there, they added chemicals, and then a pressure pumping building, all of these structures are long gone, push the water into the reactor where we're at. You can see the difference in the size. That water came in underneath the floor and up the side. We'll go through that in a minute. But it exited the reactor very quickly. In a matter of 2 to 3 seconds, the water went from front to back and went out. We show it in red because the water got very hot. Ambient river temperature today is probably 55 degrees or so. That water, in that 2 to 3 seconds that it took to go from front to back and out, rose to, in the night after a big modification in the 1950s, to over 190 degrees. So you can see how important it was to take the heat out and the importance of the water. We'll go into that a little bit more detail, because it was really an engineering marvel how they did that. The water came in, and we'll show you what we call the valve pit, where the water is coming in. It came in on two large pipes that are about 10 feet below where you're sitting. And then up either side of the reactor, here, you see the gray, through these cross centers, and then on in to each of these process tubes by virtue of this flexible pipe here. Loading this reactor, I'm going to talk to you a little bit, dive into the physics just a little bit. The real physics expert is over there, so he'll measure me very carefully. But we'll talk about that in a second. So to load this reactor, they would stage fuel here. If you look over on your left, you see that box that's got the word natural on it. It's got 32 holes in it. Each of those boxes, they would be staged here, would hold 32 fuel elements. The fuel looked like this. This is the actual size of the uranium that went into the reactor, a pure natural metal, and not enriched, just natural. And then it was encased in an aluminum can. And the reason for that is similar to not getting water on the graphite. You could not get water on the uranium. If you did, it would swell. And when we show you, here's a chunk of the process tube. With the fuel in there, you can see there's a very narrow annulus around that. That is where the water is flowing through the flexible connection. So very little water, but you could not get water on the fuel, so they protected the fuel with the aluminum can. So let's talk about the physics a little bit. Natural uranium is made up of two principal isotopes. The biggest isotope in terms of amount is uranium-238. It makes up better than 99% of any mass of uranium that is mined and then refined to go in the reactor. Statistically, 99.3%. The other 0.7% is another isotope, uranium-235. 235 is the same atomic number, 92, but it has three less neutrons. As a result of that odd number of neutrons, it is unstable, but it is also one of just two elements, well, maybe three, that we say that are fissile. By that we mean it will fission in the presence of slow neutrons. So how does that happen? The fuel would be loaded in this reactor in this manner. They'd put in 16 spacers, look like this. This is a real one. And then they would put in 32 fuel elements. Again, one of those boxes full of fuel. And then they would put in another 16 spacers. And the reason for that was to center the fuel in the graphite. Uranium sitting out here where the shielding is would not react. But in here, it's going to react. How does that happen? This was Fermi's great discovery for which he won the Nobel Prize in 1938. His great discovery in his laboratory in Rome in 1934. It was almost one of those serendipity moments in science where he meant to do one thing, but he didn't. He did another thing, and voila, he discovered something. What they discovered was that neutrons in certain materials, the neutrons are slowed down by the nature of the material. He figured out, or he noticed, graphite is one of those. What happens is the neutron collides with the carbon atom, and the carbon atom does not absorb the neutron, it reflects it. It reflects it, and slows it down. It turns out that uranium-235 will absorb a slow neutron, and then you can create the chain reaction, the fission reaction. Ordinarily, neutrons are moving very, very fast. The science says maybe 22,000 kilometers per second, roughly 13 to 14,000 miles per second. It turns out in the right moderator, and that's what we refer to in the graphite, those neutrons are slowed way, way down to just kilometers per second. The physics are such that when a neutron collides with another 235 nucleus, if it's moving at that fast speed, it just zips by, nothing happens. But with the moderator slowing it down, it gives time for that nucleus to absorb that neutron. And when it absorbs it, it splits the nucleus, and you have two major fission products and a host of other smaller fission products. And when it does that, though, it causes that 235 nucleus to release 2 to 3 neutrons, 2.4 on the average, it ranges out. And then another uranium-235 nucleus can absorb a neutron, and it splits, and it releases 2 to 3, and it sets up the chain reaction. These charts on the wall you can look at in your free time give you a more graphic view of that. But essentially, what Fermi discovered was that certain materials will slow down the neutrons, and it turns out the neutrons, that you multiply those neutrons and you set up the chain reaction. That's what the reactor does. That's what he demonstrated in Chicago on December 2nd, 1943, with a very, very small power load. So now we have a chain reaction. We've loaded the reactor, and now we're going to operate it. So we raise the verticals with the poison in them, they're out now, otherwise would absorb neutrons. The operators in the control room then begin to articulate the horizontal control rods, pulling them out, looking at their instruments until the reaction comes up. This is a horizontal control rod as opposed to the vertical. It also is stainless steel and has three cooling channels in it. That is why it's shaped this way. And it has a small amount of boron, as does the vertical rod. Boron in the industry is referred to as a poison. It absorbs neutrons. So the presence of the verticals and horizontals with that small amount of boron in them keeps that chain reaction from building, no matter what the operators do, until those controls are out and that fission reaction can take place and set up the chain reaction. So now we've got a chain reaction going on. One other very significant thing happens. The whole idea behind this reactor is something called transmutation takes place. It turns out that that greater mass of uranium-238, that makes up that 99.3%, will absorb a slow neutron. It won't fission, but it'll absorb the neutron. So uranium-238 now becomes uranium-239. It is heavier by one neutron. That is a very unstable element, uranium-239. And in a matter of less than a half hour, it decays away and becomes neptunium-239. Neptunium is also very unstable. In a matter of about 2.5 days, it decays to plutonium-239. That's what they were after. So two essential processes going on. The fission chain reaction that allow the slowing down of neutrons and creating the chain reaction, and then the absorption by uranium-238 of slow neutrons to transmute to another element, plutonium-239. Very little uranium would transmute that way. Roughly speaking, if you remember the video they said about a pound per ton. If you took eight of these tubes fully loaded, you would have about a ton of uranium sitting in them. Out of that ton, by the time it was processed in the separation plants, your yield on the average would be 1.5 pound of plutonium. So you can see the amount of uranium that was needed in order to create that very small amount. The creation of the plutonium was a function of the power of the reactor. This reactor original design, 250 megawatts thermal. On the average, you could create 1 gram of plutonium per megawatt day. So with this reactor fully loaded, at 250 megawatts, you are creating roughly 250 grams of plutonium a day. 28 grams to the pound, if you want to do that, or to the ounce, excuse me, and you can do your math on that. So that was the process. So when they had reached a point, as you can imagine, the greatest neutron flux is in the middle of the reactor. So on the average, this is strictly average, every 4 to 6 weeks they would shut the reactor down. They'd bring the horizontals in. They would drop the verticals, which were the safety feature. And then they would do a discharge, usually 10 to 20% of the reactor. And generally speaking, in the center of the reactor is where the greatest reactivity was. So 10 to 20%, 200 to 400 tubes. They go up on the elevator, they identify the tubes they were going to do a discharge. They go around to the rear face of the reactor, and you notice all of these are numbered. You can see it on here. And on the rear face, the workers would remove the caps. The water has been turned off to those channels. Come back around using the elevator. They would do the same thing here. They'd go up to each one of these, remove the nozzle cap, and then using these devices you see here, we call them charging machines. And you see the slanted tray on them, there's a pair of them here. They would push the fuel out. In pushing the fuel out, the rear spacers fell out into 20 feet of water. The fuel fell out into 20 feet of water. At this point, these are highly radioactive and thermally hot. The front spacers became new rear spacers, 16 or 32 fresh fuel elements, 16 spacers, put the cap back on. They'd go through that in a good day, they could do 50 tubes in an 8-hour shift. So after a couple of days, they would have this reactor charged again, and they would start the reactor up again and go through the process over and over again. And that was the process throughout. Well, in later years, they raised the power level of the reactor, particularly when the Cold War really got going in the early 50s. To create more plutonium because of the advent of thermonuclear weapons, the hydrogen bomb, if you will. This reactor, by the time it was shut down in the mid-60s, was running at over 2,000 megawatts, almost 10 times its original design from a thermal standpoint. So that's the story. A lot of information thrown at you. I miss anything, Gene? Anything? Okay, we got everything covered. Sometimes I get going and I'll skip over things. But again, the central message here, with the discovery of the transmutation process by those two chemists at the University of California, they now knew that a thing called a reactor with fission chain reaction could create that atmosphere to create that new substance, plutonium. And that's what this reactor and this what the whole site was all about.
I'd give a lot of dough if only I could know The answer to my question, is it yes or is it no? Does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? If your mother says don't chew it, do you swallow it in spite? Can you catch it on your tonsils? Can you heave it left and right? Does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? Here comes a blushing bride, the groom is by her side. Up to the altar, just as steady as Gibraltar, while the groom has got the ring, and it's such a pretty thing. But as he slips it on her finger, the choir begins to sing. Does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? If your mother said don't chew it, do you swallow it in spite? Can you catch it on your tonsils? Can you heave it left and right? Does your chewing gum lose its flavor on the bedpost overnight? Now the nation rises one to send their honored sons up to the White House. Yeah, the nation's only White House to voice their discontent unto the president upon the burning question, what has swept this continent? If tin whistles are made of tin, what do they make foghorns out of?
Bumble!
Does your chewing gum lose its flavour on the bedpost overnight? If your mother said don't chew it, do you swallow it in spite? Can you catch it on your tonsils? Can you heave it left and right? Does your chewing gum lose its flavour on the bedpost overnight? On the bedpost overnight.
Well, then, I love you and I want to hold you tight.
A Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday night. On the bedpost overnight.
Dollar is a dollar and a dime is a dime.
He's singing another chorus, but he hasn't got the time.
On the bedpost overnight.
We had a shift supervisor who would wander. We had a chief operator who would sit in this chair and be responsible for all these instruments. Then there'd be a couple more, at least two, maybe three more operators who are responsible for collecting data. Then in addition, in the building, there would be an instrumentation technician and a radiation monitor. That's the during operations staffing, maybe 10 people. When we're in a shutdown mode where they're replacing fuel or doing maintenance, different story, a lot more people potentially. In the total B complex, while there may only be 10 here because there's water treatment plants and steam plants and office facilities and maintenance and repair facilities, there may be 400 people in the B area. So it's not a small operation. Big processes here. We're first to monitor the pressure of the, there's 2004 pressure tubes. Each one of them has a panelit gauge associated with it. That's what these are. They measure the pressure. There's a quarter-inch copper tube on the back side. You can see them from the end. It goes into each one of these two holes, measuring the pressure drop across a process tube. Two numbers here allow you to, I'm looking at a number here, 2551. If you were to go out to the front of the reactor, you could see there's a 25 and a 51 and identify where that tube is in the reactor. So, pressure. It's a relative pressure gauge, pressure drop across the tube. If it's too high, that means the tube is blocked. Water is not going through it. It's going to heat up, it's going to melt, you got a problem. If it's too low, too much water is going through, that means you've got a rupture and you're going to lose water and you've got another problem. So it's got to be in between. If either any one of these 2004 tubes is out of spec, it scrams the reactor. That means it shuts down the reactor. Scram is a fancy word. It means unplanned shutdown. Bumping the panel could also cause a scram, which is a reason why there's probably a sign up there as a reminder. So the purpose of this is measuring the pressure. Now, over here, we have temperature measurement. Each one of the 2004 tubes has temperature on the outlet side. Inlet side, we know, is coming roughly from the Columbia River. It's about 55 degrees, 50 degrees, somewhere in there. So by using this adaptation of a telephone switchboard, which is what it is, you plug it in, you can punch the right button for the right tube that you want, and you then measure the temperature of that tube, and you write it down by hand. So every shift, Those two operators are doing 2004 pressure engineer majors. Yeah, okay. So, engineer, as you know, if you know the diameter of 2004 pressure measurements, 2004 temperature measurements. Why? Because, here's any physicists here? Physics, engineer, majors? Yeah, okay. So, engineer, as you know, if you know the diameter, the effective diameter of a pipe, of a tube, and I call it effective because in our process tube we have a fuel element, and the effective diameter is that little annular space around the fuel element. So if we know the effective diameter of the tube, we know the pressure drop across the tube, and we know the density of the fluid, the water flowing through the tube, we know the flow rate through the tube, right? Okay, so we know the flow rate. Now over here, if we know the temperature drop across the tube, we know the change in the heat that's been added to the tube. So we combine the flow rate and the heat together, and we know how much heat, how much energy has been injected into that tube. That energy is direct, that heat is directly related to the energy, which are the 200 megawatts, which is directly related to the number of neutrons flowing, or what we call the neutron flux, which is directly related to the amount of plutonium being produced in that tube. So by doing these 2004 measurements for temperature and pressure, we can, and knowing the time, we can tell how much plutonium has been produced in each tube. And for that reason, we started out doing these by hand. After, in the 1950s, this flexi writer was adapted kind of from a teletype machine and could do in 10 minutes what would have taken those two operators 3 hours. Paper for recording temperatures, you'll see it says secret when filled in, because the production rate of plutonium was a secret, was a top secret. And but by knowing the production rate, you would know when you need to discharge the fuel from an element, from one of those process tubes. So that's the processing measurements that are critical here. So now we have, in addition, the operator sitting here. He has, first off, he has 29 vertical safety rods. You may remember those that come in from the top of the reactor. Over here on my left, behind a plexiglass panel, if you want to count them, there are 29 plus levers or switches that control, raise and lower each one of those control rods. In addition, remember the 9 horizontal rods that come in from the side of the reactor. So those are physically located right over our heads. And here's a model that shows how they're configured, sort of. 7 of the 9 rods are hydraulically operated for course adjustment. The 2 top rods on the outside are electrically operated to give you fine-tuning capability. They're operated from this panel. The operator would be sitting here. Gosh, that's not a comfortable chair. The operator would be sitting here. He has these buttons to press to select one of those 9 control rods, and then he can raise or he can insert or withdraw the rod using these switches. The position of those rods is identified by one of these 9 pages. Tells you where they're located. Engineers, being what they are, always say, "What if? What if those rods jam? We need to have a backup method for shutting down the reactor." One of the backup methods was, when they first built the reactor, was to put for each one of the 29 vertical safety rods, there was a tank containing boric acid solution. And if that rod jammed, a valve would open the tank, the water would flow down into that channel, that vertical channel, flood the reactor and shut it down. Good idea. One problem: how do you get that borated water or boric acid out afterwards? You probably couldn't. If you ever had to use that system, you literally have probably killed the reactor. I'm not going to get it started. Okay. So, didn't take them too long to figure out they needed to come up with a better idea. They took out those tanks and put in hoppers and these steel ball bearings, essentially, that are borated. And so each hopper contained these poison balls, or XXX, triple X, 3X poison balls. When I was a kid, I remember XXX was a symbol for poison. And so if the rod jammed, that hopper would open up, the balls would drop down into the reactor, into those vertical channels, shut down the reactor. How do you get them out afterwards?
Up on top is our giant vacuum cleaners, more than one. Literally giant vacuum cleaners. This switch here was for tripping or opening those valves if you needed to. Now, it's interesting that there's a little plexiglass over it. On a tour a few years back, a lady came to me, you never talked about what you did, or your work was, so you didn't talk about it with your spouse. And she said her husband came home one night, outraged, very angry, upset, and she couldn't get him, he wouldn't talk about what happened, but it was obvious something had happened to work. All she'd say was, we dropped the ball. Well, when she came through on the tour and heard the story about how these balls were, she put it together and realized that she thought what had happened was that night they had accident, somebody had flipped that switch and dropped the balls. Which is why we think there's a plexiglass box over it. Yeah.
Smart.
Among the other things the operator here did, he had two gauges here, looked like displays like that, and were operated by a little light source here called a galvanometer, sat behind back in here. The galvanometer would move a light beam across the gradient that you see here, and one of these would monitor the power level of the reactor, and the other one would monitor whether it was going up or down, its rate of increase or rate of decrease. So that's the job, basically, of the guy sitting here.
Green Douglas fir where the waters cut through, down her wild mountains and canyons she flew, Canadian Northwest to the ocean so blue, it's roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Your power is turning our darkness to dawn. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Other great rivers add power to you. Yakima Snake and the Clicky Tattoo. Sandy, Willamette, and Hood River, too. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. It's there on your banks that we fought many a fight. Sheridan's boys and the blockhouse at night. They saw us in death, but never in flight. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Your power is turning our darkness to dawn. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Our loved ones we lost there at Cole's little store, by fireball and rifle a dozen or more. We won by the Mary and soldier she bore. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Remember the trial when the battle was won, the wild Indian warriors to the tall timber run. We hung ever Indian with smoke in his gun. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Year after year we had tedious trials, fighting the rapids and cascades and downs. The engines rest peaceful on Mamaloo Sound. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Your power is turning our darkness to dawn. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. At Bonneville now there is ships in the locks. Waters have risen and drowned at the rocks. Shiploads of plenty will steam in the docks. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. On up the river at Grand Coulee Dam, mightiest thing ever built by a man, to run the great factories for old Uncle Sam. It's roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Roll on, Columbia, roll on. Your power is turning darkness to dawn. Roll on.